In many respects, the summer campaign of 1942 was the high watermark for the Wehrmacht. After the siege of Sevastopol, there was little work for the Karls to do, as it was now the turn of the German armies to come under siege. But the Karl class of self-propelled siege gun had proved itself successful in action. Unfortunately, the same could not always be said for Hitler's other innovations. The Karl represented the very large end of weapons development. These men are training with the other extreme, both in size and success. This was Goliath, one of three of the so-called demolition tanks made by Germany in the war. It was a miniature remote control tank, which was designed to be guided up to enemy tanks or pillboxes, then detonated. Although this footage shows troops training with these weapons, it is obvious, even from this, that the operators had to expose themselves to hostile enemy positions in order to have any prospect of guiding the suicide weapon onto its target. In consequence, casualties were very high, and this job was very unpopular among the troops operating machines such as the Borgward B4 or the Goliath. Nonetheless, over 7,500 remote-controlled demolition tanks were built and used by the troops in the field. Their success rate is not recorded, but the ratio of failures to successes was high. The Karl and the Goliath represented very much the unconventional end of the military spectrum.
Now, the Goliath here was another rather fancy idea. It's basically a tiny tracked vehicle packed with high explosive, which is directed onto its target by remote control. The Germans actually built a number of these things, either worked by radio, or in this case by wire, reeling out from the vehicle, like a little child's toy with a battery box at the back. And the men would guide it onto its target. Again, you could only really expect to use a thing like this against fixed defences, and it was the very nature of German warfare to keep mobile, so one wonders where they anticipated using it half the time. I've seen film of Goliath in which the thing is virtually incapable of staying the right way up on anything but dead level ground. And of course, the further away it is from the operator, the more difficult it is for him to aim. And once the opposition figure out what it is, they're going to do all in their power to stop it. It only requires a shot cutting the wire to finish it. We developed similar things in Great Britain. They were all considered to be a completely useless effort. None of them ever worked properly. And I would say the same must be said for poor old Goliath. There is a famous photograph, I think taken in Italy, of a US Army soldier standing on a mountain of the darn things. And I can imagine the German Army saying, to hell with it, these things are simply not worth bothering with. All the trouble of carrying to the site, setting them up, probably to waste it the minute the thing breaks down halfway to target.
Today, the rusting hulks of the armoured fighting vehicles of the Wehrmacht lie still and silent under a summer sun. This is the U.S. Army Ordnance Museum Foundation in Maryland, USA. Final resting place for many of the survivors of the titanic struggle on the Russian front. The white winter camouflage contrasts incongruously with the green summer grass and blue skies. These machines, which once brought terror to the continent of Europe, now lie rusting silently away. Among the well-known tanks such as the Panther and the Tiger are a few less familiar names: the Hummel, the Wespe, and the Grasshopper. But in their day, when these drab white color schemes served a real purpose on the snow-covered steppes of Russia, their contribution was every bit as vital as the famous tanks in the spearhead. The use of tracked vehicles to support the objectives of the Wehrmacht had grown exponentially since the start of World War II in 1939. Even in 1941, only 19 of the 140 German divisions deployed for the invasion of Russia were panzer divisions. The army of 1942 was much more mobile. Panzer grenadiers moving swiftly around the battlefield in armored half-tracks were much more numerous. But even mobile infantry still required artillery support to achieve many of their objectives. That artillery support needed to be as mobile as they were. The Sturmgeschütz assault gun had originally been designed to provide this support, but by 1942, battlefield necessities meant that they were often hijacked into the role of tank destroyers. This deprived the troops of close artillery support, which the Geschütz were originally designed to provide. It left a gap which could not be filled by the medium or heavy artillery. These heavier guns often lagged behind the motorized troops across the huge distances which had to be covered in Russia. In Europe, during the campaigns of 1939, 40 and 41, where roads were good, it was found that conventional artillery could be moved and deployed reasonably easily. But in Russia, the dirt roads turned to rivers of mud with the arrival of spring and autumn rains, and they were frequently covered in deep snow during the winter months. The best possible solution for the provision of heavy artillery support for the mobile battles now being fought in Russia was the deployment of large caliber self-propelled guns on fully tracked carriages. These vehicles could stick reasonably close to the fast-moving panzer divisions and provide them with the same heavy artillery support which would normally require horse-drawn or motorized transport. They were collectively known as Sturmartillerie, or self-propelled guns. These troops seen here during the German advance into the Caucasus in 1942 are towing their gun into action. But to get into action, the gun has to be first unlimbered. At this point, the crew will be exposed to enemy fire. The heavy 15-centimeter infantry gun could be mounted on a tracked chassis to produce a vehicle which was always ready for action, and which gave the crew a measure of protection against artillery fire, and which could keep pace with the spearheads over the worst possible terrain. The self-propelled artillery units had been born. The first self-propelled guns proved effective. But as the war wore on and Germany's situation grew increasingly desperate, her hard-pressed armies found themselves facing superior firepower from increasingly heavy enemy artillery. To combat this, the Wehrmacht needed a variety of mobile gun platforms capable of moving heavy artillery to hard-pressed sections over the vast battlefields of Russia. Ultimately, thousands of self-propelled guns in a bewildering variety of variations would see action. Although it was the insistent demands of the Russian front which provide the real catalyst for the development of self-propelled guns, there were a number of earlier precedents. Limited numbers of self-propelled guns, called Schwerinfanteriegeschütz, or SIG for short, had been successfully deployed in the 1940 campaign in France. Initially, these vehicles used the ridiculously light Panzer I chassis to carry the heavy 15-centimeter infantry gun. The troops advancing here are using the gun to blast infantry from buildings and strong points. And despite the obvious limitations of these first self-propelled guns, it was actions like these that convinced the High Command that there was a role for fully mobile heavy artillery carried on a tracked chassis. The Panzer I was Germany's first and smallest tank, secretly developed as an agricultural tractor during the years when Germany was prevented from developing tanks by the Treaty of Versailles. It was very much a starting point. It was a two-man machine, smaller than many modern saloon cars. It soon proved to be hopelessly inadequate under combat conditions. The armor was too thin,